So good morning, everyone. So 2 years ago in the south of France, I presented already a part of this study, but we've done some progress in the meantime, some little progress. So for the one who completely forgot or were not here last time, so I will briefly recall my experimental setup. So we have a deformed fosterite, which is the magnesium end member of another mineral called olivine, which contains magnesium and iron. This is an orthorhombic crystal, an orthorhombic silicate. And why olivine? So it's I'm a geologist. So why geologists are obsessed by olivine, at least a part of the geologist. So if we cut a slide inside our planet, we can look at it. So you know it's composed of different layers. I think that everybody knows that. But there is different classification of the layers. The first classification is a chemical, is based on the chemical composition. So this is this part of this nice cake. So we have the crust, then what we call the upper mantle, then the lower mantle, then the core. The crust is more enriched in silica than the mantle. And the core is mostly composed of iron with a little bit of nickel and just a little bit of silicon at the trace element level. And olivine is basically composing between 60 and 80% of this pale green layer here. And we have the other classification, which is based on the strength of the different chemical, of the strength of the different layers inside the Earth. So the first layer is here. It's a little bit too gray. This is a tectonic plate, really at the surface of the planet. And they're moving laterally. And below we have another layer, so this pale purple layer, which is convecting. Okay, the Earth is cooling down, generating convection. And again below we have at the center the outer core, which is liquid and convecting as well, and the inner core, which is solid and not convecting. And you can notice that there is not a really good match between the chemical layers and the mechanical layers. And our very important olivine here, composing the pale green layer, is actually the mineral composing, so the rock composing, this very important interface where there is a partial mechanical coupling between the plate tectonics moving and producing earthquake at their boundaries and the convecting at asthenosphere here. Okay, so we have some little specific term for geologists, but remember, so we have the plate tectonics at the surface and something convecting in between, and right at the interface here, this is made of this green material, essentially composed of olivine. So let's go back to the lab. So my olivine, but without the iron, is called fosterite. We add a little bit of a brother mineral, which is instatite, which is a little bit enriched in silica. This is to buffer the silica activity and not to generate too much vacancies. It's very small grains for us. So small in my world mean microns. And we're going to deform those hot pressed dense fosterite aggregate under confining pressure of 300 MPa and temperature between 900 degrees and 1200 degrees Celsius. The experiment, we compress them in axial compression with a constant displacement weight, which will give a strain rate of 10 to minus 5 per second. So this is fast, something that supervisors and PhD students and postdocs like very much because I correspond to one experiment per day. But of course, this is not the case in the Earth where the strain rate is between 10 to minus 16 per second and 10 to minus 12 per second, okay, which isn't compatible with any PhDs. So this is how this nice, very nice, almost nano grain size fosterite looks like. We have some weak metal sleeve around. And we can play with it, you can put it on the iPhone, and it's very nicely translucent. So the grain boundaries are really, really tight, it's very nice starting material. This is a hot press vessel we are using, this is the outside part, this is the inside part, and we'll place our little samples here right in the center. And it's a very nice, so the length is basically 1 centimeter size, okay? And diameter is like seven to eight millimeters. It's a very nice apparatus to do deformation in almost geological condition because we have an internal furnace as well as an internal load cell which permit to reduce thermal gradients as well as all the friction you can have in normal apparatus. And the most important parameter is this guy here, which is Julien Gasque, who done the postdoc with me in Montpellier, and is currently setting up one of the experiments. So I will show you the mechanical curves, the BSD maps obtained by MTEX, and the new staff this year is the TEM. Okay, so the starting material. The starting material was produced by hot pressed nanophosphorite in Japan, and compared to what we usually are able to produce in olivin, here you see very nice grand boundaries, straight and straight, nice triple junction and so on. So normally our hot pressed starting material are not as nice as this one. So we were pretty excited to squeeze this one. There is almost no porosity, very, very low. So great starting material. So here's the deformation curve, so the stress in megapascal as a function of thin strain. So we go up to 10%. So we deform at 900 degrees Celsius. Oh yeah, so this is a temperature code. 900 degrees Celsius where the sample is too hard and breaks. Then you increase the temperature, so the steady state, we succeed to reach steady state. And here you have the hottest temperature of deformation, 1200 degrees C, with a nice steady state curve. And we get steady state, even if the maximal steady state stress is well above the confining pressure, which was 300 MPa. Okay, so first EBSD map will compare the lowest temperature with the highest temperature. So this is a mean-to-mean map. We have the angle here, so the maximum is 1 degree, so nothing much is happening in this sample. No? It's mostly blue with somewhere yellow grains. At higher temperature, it's a little bit more encouraging, so more yellow grains, and you see some feature developing in the large grains, but that will kill your enthusiasm. The scale is only going from 0 to 5 degrees. So there is altogether not that much misorientation in these samples. So let's compare them. So actually, this is also what I did. So okay, so this is definitely more greenish and yellow, but it's altogether not that much misorientation. For the one who likes the CPO, so we also try to be overly positive here. So there is basically something will start to look like something, but actually my postdoc plotted the inverse way, so the dark color is the lowest density, not the highest. And if you calculate the J index, you go from 1 point something to 1 point something. So we can dig some features, but it's not that great. But we still have those great deformation curves, which show steady state. So something has to happen in the samples. So we went, some extra statistics from MTEX. So here's a function of the temperature. So here at 20 degrees C, this is the starting materials. So basically no drastic change in grain size, no drastic change in aspect ratio, okay, from 1.8 to 2.0. Nothing drastic in the shape factor, it's a little bit more, but altogether from 1.4 to 1.5. Mm-hmm, okay, so then the postdocs have to be really depressed at this point in the project. The only things which it's kind of little pop-up in those experiments is a grain orientation spread. It's expressed in an angle. So as soon as you have a little bit of high temperature kicking in the system, so the grain orientation spread increases a little bit. But we have seen that also from the misorientation maps. Okay, then we decided to go back to basics and to really spend more time to look at the samples, okay? Something is not showing up in the MTEX treatments of basic TEM, but we wanted to have a look a little bit more. So this is SEM images from the lowest temperature to the highest temperature. So you have some pluckouts, of course, but what we'll see also is that we have some gaps opening, okay? And not all of them are pluckout. This is zooming in, and what you start to see is this sort of out-of-plane displacement that we actually see everywhere, okay? And you see, so the grain boundaries remain very nice. We increase temperature, so the microstructure change a little bit, but we still have those holes, so gaps, voids, I don't really know how to call it. And in one sample at 1250, we get something that normally we only see in textbooks. Okay, nice evidence of grain boundary sliding. So you have also some grand boundaries which show some serration, and it seems to be everywhere, okay, some very geometrical opening of the grand boundaries. And this is the first time we see that in olivine. For the up to now, to describe grain boundary sliding in olivine, we only had cartoons. So this is a nice example that, okay, it is happening, at least in my lab, not necessarily in the earth. Okay, we increase temperature, so the texture changed a little bit, it seems to be more dense at 1110 degrees Celsius. Okay, we also see, even if it is in the fourth scatter images, some substructure appearing. And but you still have gaps, okay? We still have things to really show, seems to prove that grains have slid relative to one to another. 1200 degrees Celsius, completely different, typical dislocation creep features of olivine, so high temperature features. And you can even see so some grain boundaries activities, okay? So like here, and no gaps, no voids, no asperities along the grain boundaries. So, and because I'm very picky and I'm lucky to have good colleagues in France who are really good in TEM, so I asked to Patrick Cordier to have a look to those weird samples. We go back to a presentation as a function of temperature, so 950 degrees Celsius, so you have nice grains, very nice, almost straight grain boundaries, but they are open, they are cracked, okay? But some of them also remain closed, so another image is here. So you have a closed grain boundary, already open grain boundary. Even we have this one with a sort of teeth, peaks, asperities, or decoration cells. We're still fighting with each other to know how we're going to call that. So we're going to zoom into this one. So okay, so closed, nice, tight grain boundaries, and open grain boundaries, and some steps. But if I say steps, you will start to think it's already disconnection, but maybe not. So it's opening in a weird way. And this is also coexisting with dislocations, okay? So it's not only cracking the grain boundaries. Okay, we continue. 1050 degrees Celsius, and we have this very nice, almost geometrical opening. Okay, with some decoration cells as well on the border. And you can see, okay, it moved, but you cannot really pull that back together perfectly. You will have overlap of materials, which is also what the theory of grain boundary sliding is predicting. But it can be, it can be quite drastic, okay, with large opening. Some are still opening, and you also still have grain boundaries which remain tight. And remember, so the confining pressure is 300 MPa, and the bulk steady state stress is well above the confining pressure. Okay, so one of the most extreme gaps forming in those samples with those decoration cells, which also you can call crocodile teeth, is how it was called for a long time, this project. Okay, and so it looks something ductile even if the outcome is something brittle. Okay, and this is just as a, so after we saw the most dramatic effect, we started to look for the really initiation of this mechanism. So you have again like a cracked grain boundary, and you have this grain which is moving maybe up and down or left and right. It's not that clear in this one, but with again those cells opening along the grain boundaries. Okay, and if you increase temperature, okay, you can also find big grains where you have the crocodile teeth or decoration cells on the borders, and it's still full of dislocations. Okay, so it's not like a single mechanism, and it happens that geologists, we like to simplify very much our mechanism of deformation. We like to have only one. So here, this is an example how they can coexist. They can coexist. Okay, so you have the different images, and you have those steps or teeth or whatever, but that we didn't prove yet that they were eventually crystallographically controlled. Okay, we're suspicious about that, but what we have now is not that clear. And at 1200 degrees Celsius, no gaps, no teeth, no asperity, no cracked grain boundaries. We go back to a very classical, geologically relevant in the convecting part of the Earth, so tight grain boundaries and dislocations. Okay, tight grain boundaries and little forests. Okay, so what do we have? We have low temperature, which is different than high temperature. SEM seems to be quite important if we want to, we cannot base our conclusion only on EBSD and MTEX. And SEM, so we get even some very cartoonish evidence of grain boundary sliding. We have this out of displacement, which can be related to relaxation after we have deformed the sample. We see cracked grain boundaries. It's something between brittle and viscous activity along the grain boundaries. And in TEM, so we have proof that dislocation easily coexists with grain boundary activity, and both can be extreme. So keep in mind that the bulk, the stress, the applied force lead to a bulk stress which is well above the confining pressure, which is the opposite in the earth, okay? So let's go back shortly to the deformation curves. So Julien also is really likes elasticity, so he really wanted to identify this yield point for each curve. So he done some medical treatment to be sure where is the best place to put that, and then he plotted as a function of temperature. So he has a sort of apparent Young modulus for this mineral, derived from the yield point in gigapascal, and you see that with the increase in temperature, you have a decrease of the participation of the viscoelasticity of the grain boundary. And it happened that it also matched some recent articles from San Carlos olivine, so the mineral with the iron and not without the iron, like we had us. But experiments were deformed at higher confining pressure, so whereas confining pressure exceeds the applied the stress, the steady state stress. Okay. So to conclude, I learned my lesson with this project. So I really like EBSD and MTEX. It's a very powerful tool, but we should not skip the basics, SEM and TEM. So this is also something which geologists wanted to discard, but dislocation and grain boundary activity could coexist very well together. And for me, this set of experiments is an open door to try to understand what is really the physics behind grain boundary sliding. It happens that in every textbook we get in geology, they are actually cluttered with cartoons. I still have time, actually. It's too fast. This is the sort of things we get, okay, with the classical overlapping of the material and gaps, and all this sort of, I think most of you have seen that in books. But we really have rarely images of real minerals and silicate composing in our planet, okay? So where in Earth could I have that? It's happening in the lab, but is it possible to have that in the Earth? So we need like a very small grain size. So here the grain size is 1 to 2 to 5 microns. In the Earth we have giant grain size, it's 2 to 5 millimeters. Mm-hmm. How do we make a grain of 5 millimeters sliding against each other? And you have seen this morning, I don't know if you remember, but Mark had a very nice little movie, who was walking of a giant gold crystals moving, sliding against other gold crystals, but there were free surface on the left and on the right. So it's easy to have one grain sliding when there is nobody in front or behind. In the Earth, there will be no porosity at all. So how do we have grains sliding each other when the confining pressure, so what we call the lithostatic pressure in the Earth, is higher than the stresses? So then we need high stresses, so it could be possible with some heterogeneities. This is something we try to work out. We also need high strain weight, which is not impeded by the competitive ionic diffusion, because in the Earth we have time, it's hot and we have plenty of time. So we need to lower the temperature, so it has to be lower than 1100 degrees Celsius. So it should be actually concomitant with the pressure. So all of this is giving us like a crystal domain. So we have to bring, okay, this pale green layer very close to the surface and deforming very strongly. So this is could be possible at the border of some plate tectonics, what we call shear zone, okay, made of mantle material. But it happened that we have Alain in the room, which is a specialist of shear zone, mantle shear zone in the Earth. And I bothered him for like 3 months, where could I have that in the Earth? And up to now, I don't have a clear location to propose you where this is possible. So the only thing I could get, this is what the shear zone is, okay? So this is from a fault going way down to the mantle. So you have a fault at the first surface, like say St. Andreas fault, okay? Going down way in the green part, which is my mantle. But this is how a rock of the mantle deforming the shear zone would look like, okay? Which is not the microstructure you have seen in my experiment. So here you have a very, very small grain size and the big grains, the porphyroclast remaining. So grain boundary sliding, then maybe if the stress is high enough, if the temperature is cool enough, and if the strain and if the grain size remain small, maybe it could happen here, okay? And this is one of the cut we can have across the shear zone. I think, do I still have time or not? Okay, so this is what I learned. Okay, some very distinct mechanisms, so diffusion and dislocation and grain motion and so on, with a book from a very famous geologist, okay, Jean-Paul Poirier. And actually, in now, in the research group in Montpellier, we are more